anybody who needs to loosen their belts can loosen their belts. Anybody who needs to have a stretch can have a stretch, because this is, given the lawyer killer, given the evil professor, and then the good people to balance them out, should be an interesting session. We're basically going to be talking about social enterprise. If you look up on the screen, that blueprint was launched last month. Question for a lot of people, really, Leisha, can a social enterprise, does it work here? Will it work here? Is that a sustainable sort of model, or, you know, is it just a flight of fancy? Then the other question is that IP in social enterprise, how does that work, right? So big question marks there, which is why we've got all these incredible people to, well, take you through that, answer some questions. Hopefully there'll be questions. Failing which evil professor? She moved up. You scared her, Scott. She moved up front. This poor lady actually moved up front so that Scott wouldn't ask her a question. So, which is a warning for those of you who are still at the back. Scott's coming for you. So let me quickly introduce you to your moderator for this afternoon. And that's Azmir Mukhtar. He is the managing director and principal partner of Prima Asia Pacific Consulting. He's going to tell you a little bit about all the other people who are here, and that's about as formal as we get for a few presentations. And you ask lots and lots of questions. Deal? Deal. Great. Take it away.
Very good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I do hope you can stay awake. My PO has informed me that this room is being declared as a snooze-free room. So you are not allowed to snooze in any way. We are very fortunate that this afternoon we'll be entertained and keep awake.
Entertained.
I'm not sure which one is it. By two gentlemen, two Mr. Alpha and two Madam Alpha, to make everyone have a better understanding about social entrepreneurship. I have not seen this blueprint. I mean, the first time I'm looking at it, I didn't even know that Malaysia have a social enterprise blueprint. Okay, so we're going to start. I mean, have any of you seen this blueprint? Please put up your hand. Please put up your hand. One, good, great. I mean, if someone is reading about, is reading on rooting blueprints, anyone else? Who wants to know more about the secret behind the blueprint? Wow, that's great. You are in the right room. Here are the secrets on how you're going to make a lot of money from the... No, it's not supposed to make money, right? Oh, sorry, no, I'm not supposed to use the word money at all. So we're going to make a lot of wealth. Well, not wealth.
Impact.
Yeah, impact. Okay, significance to the community in the world through social entrepreneurship. So I'm going to start our session today by... Oh, yeah, I have to introduce who are the speakers. Yes, right at the end there, we have... I have to get her name right. First, I took my glasses on. Dr. Shariha Khalid. She is the co-founder and executive of the Scope Group. She goes around and get people together to explore new ideas and so on. It's about right in there. In a simple way.
Yeah.
Okay, never mind. Next to her is Khairul. Yeah, Khairul Anwar. He is the one that is trying to
kill the lawyers.
Yeah. Well, okay, he's trying to assassinate the lawyers. Okay, that is quite a new role for you. So you're going to talk about it today, isn't it? I mean, you're going to talk today about it in this session. Good. And we have Ngayuan. Hello, Ngayuan. Yeah, she is an artist. She is in the inner field of arts, and trying to get people to go into it. Is that right? No, I don't think so. Well, you probably will tell her more about herself to this. And finally, someone is from Malaysia. Oh, I got it wrong then. Mr. Scott Gillipsy. I think he's based in Sydney.
Dubai.
Who are you?
I'm keep moving around to avoid taxes.
Your nationality? Your nationality?
I
was an American.
He was an American, okay. He was an American based in Dubai, and he did speak a lot this morning. So you can continue that for today. So you have been given 5 minutes to 10 minutes the most to say whatever you want to say. So shall we start with
the doctor?
Doctor Charlie. The doc, please.
Could I come
over
at the
to
end
you.
After the lawyer's been killed? No.
Please say anything you want to
what
say
would
about
you like
the,
me to say?
Why not you
I
say something
maybe,
about
maybe
the experience?
Maybe I'd like to ask you guys, what would you like to hear? A bit about what Scope Group does. We're a social enterprise ourselves, although we don't really define it in that way, but you know, what we do is, the reason I thought my voice was loud enough. Can you hear me?
Hello? Yeah, okay. I thought I'd ask you all what you would like to hear about today. I mean, you've got on the panel people who've worked, you know, in other countries internationally. You've got people who've worked here in Malaysia, and from different sectors. Like you and you're from the social enterprise and NGO art sector. We are Scope Group, and we're more from the sort of social impact as a whole in general, social impact. We'd work with policy as well. We run incubators, accelerators for social impact. And we've only just met today. So maybe it's better to start with how many social entrepreneurs are in the room, or how many of you work in the not-for-profit sector? Two, okay. How many of you are aspiring to become change makers, social entrepreneurs?
That's all.
Three. So why are you here? No, I'm kidding. No. When Dash asked me to come and talk about the value of IP in social entrepreneurship, I then just asked him, why do you need IP? You know, surely if you're working in this space where, you know, every IP generated, every social innovation, every new innovation or idea generated is value because it can actually help to solve a social issue, why do you want to register it as an IP? And, you know, do you really have the means and resources to be able to maintain that IP? Because an IP registration actually lasts only a couple of years for every cycle, right? So he said, just go and speak, La Shariha, about whatever you've seen. So if I'm given this opportunity for this next few minutes, maybe I'd like to sort of hear from you all as well, whether you think social innovations, i.e. innovations to address social problems, should be IP'd in the first place. What your thoughts are on that. I can share an example of a program that we did recently together with the Ministry of Finance called, it's a volunteering program, but it's actually like an impact accelerator. So you bring people together for a very limited period of time, 4 months. You have 9 different impact areas, 9 different host organizations, each either an NGO or a social enterprise, and you create or find new solutions, i.e. innovations, to address specific social problems. So we've completed that program, and there were at least 9 different IPs generated. Now, if we registered all those IPs, it means that no one else can use it unless they pay us, right? But that's not the intention. The intention is just to generate new knowledge, new innovations, and then use this to then open it up so that other people who want to solve the problem in homelessness or youth unemployment or whatever can just use this and employ it in their different organizations. So maybe that's a question to you all. Do you think NGOs, people working in the social space, should register IP? Yes, I see a few nods. Perhaps this gentleman could share why you think the social space should register IP.
Well, a couple of points. The first is that when you register IP, it gives you control of whatever that asset is. So that control allows you to have many options. One is to license it for a fee. The other is to license it free of charge. So you don't have to charge people to use an intellectual property right. You can provide a royalty-free license, which still gives the licensee some parameters as to how they can use that intellectual property right. And so I was interested, what IP did you register? Are you talking about a trademark or a patent?
We haven't registered.
Because, you know, you could already publish it under a Creative Commons license, right?
Yeah.
And you own the copyright, but it's not IP in the same sense, because, you know, at least our understanding of IP and the stuff that we're talking with the entrepreneurs and the NGOs that we sort of have in our incubator accelerator programs is that where you actually go through a formal process of registering it in a particular country, and, you know, whether it's the design or, you know, the trademark or something like that. And
what about the human library that you guys do?
So, like with the human library, actually, we don't do it, we just organize it in Malaysia. But that's a fine example of how something that started in Denmark in the year 2000, and Christopher, who's one of the co-founders of Scope, co-founded the human library about 15 years ago. When they first started, of course, it just started. The human library is a concept, you can look them up, humanlibrary.org. It's a concept whereby you go to a library. But the libraries hold human books, and you read the books in the library by engaging in conversation. So it's been around for 15 years. It's in 70 countries around the world. And the IP part is not registered as an IP. It's more capturing how you run a human library and the expectations of every organizer. So in Malaysia, Scope Group runs Human Library Malaysia. And we get the whole package from the human library, and all we have to do is we have to say that this belongs to the human library, and we're just running it at the local level.
Sorry, Zaya. What is a human library?
I just explained it just now. Oh, so really? It's a library where the books are human beings. They're people.
Yeah. So these are people who shares their stories and so on.
Yes. So
what do you do that? I mean, you record it, you actually live stream it, or you actually?
No, we don't.
Because, I mean, you put YouTube or whatever you do. I mean, is there anything of that nature?
No. The reason we don't record these reading sessions is because the books represent titles that are very marginalized populations in society. So we have human book titles such as The Sex Worker, The Person Living with HIV/AIDS, The Former Death Row Prisoner, The Drug User, you know, titles like that. So to maintain sort of privacy and confidentiality of, you know, I mean, it's just out of respect as well. Nothing's recorded. That's... Although I have to say that the Human Library organization, they are looking, because the World Bank has been very interested in engaging with them, because, you know, you can use the Human Library in many different settings in reducing barriers and creating understanding and bringing education to, you know, people who cannot read, for example. So they're trying to find a way to kind of formalize the Human Library methodology and make it more scalable than it already is, right?
Yes, I think that is something would be beneficial to all, because just looking at that, you know, you can actually expand that to a wider audience, and finding a methodology to do that, so that you actually keep the anonymity of all the some of the information and so on. I think many can share and learn from the experience. That's something that can be done, and people working on that project can create an IP of it, because, you know, From something that you're doing, people are generating something else in supporting that. Which means that in social entrepreneurship, the core organization that's involved may not be doing the real work, but the supporting organization may be able to leverage upon it and provide some other things to a wider audience. I think that's something that can be explored.
I have to say, because the gentleman raised about, you know, kind of like using IP to possibly generate revenue, right, for the organization,
it's an option.
an option. I have to say that there are some organizations around the world that do that. Social franchising, for example, can be a revenue pathway for social entrepreneurs. However, it really, you have to build it in from the very beginning if you want to go into social franchising, because the cost of generating a global IP is quite huge. So it's a balance, you know, because you could still create a social franchise without registering anything. You can just say, well, this is the price if you want to use this and my service. And okay, people might then say, oh, we don't want to pay you, we'll just copy. But ultimately, I think if you look at a lot of social organizations, they probably see it as a success if someone is actually copying them, because that person is only then going to go and create social impact wherever they are.
Yes, thank you very much. Is there any, okay, we can ask a question after this. I think next we invite yes, that's right. Are you going to continue your earlier conversation, or are you going to introduce something else?
Maybe I just continue.
Okay, why not?
Okay, because I just want to give an example about the franchise, right? You're saying that. So in 2002, there was a big panda who beats out a few wrestlers. Okay, if you don't know what it is WWF who beat WWE. Okay, there's an example because I'm supposed to bring legal perspective because I'm supposed to be a lawyer. Okay, so I'll explain while I use the word supposed afterwards. Okay, the WWF actually managed to get their name because there was two institutions which used the word WWF in 2002. Before after 2002, there's only one, which is the World Wildlife Federation. Before that, there's also the World Wrestling Federation,
yeah,
whereas The Rock is there, and there's a few other wrestlers. Okay, so what happened is they sue WWF, the Wrestling Federation, and get it. So that's the value of IP, if you want to talk about how valuable an IP is. Okay? Because they did the protection of it. So then they actually licensed it out. Okay, you can buy the knee. But I don't think they are so hung up on it. I mean, they allow people to copy it. It's more like a branding exercise, because everybody knows the WWF. They know the giant panda. Okay, and actually people can relate to it. Okay, so as a social enterprise, it's important for them. Okay, okay, in my line of work, my partner is the one who is doing IP, intellectual property. I'm actually more of a property lawyer. Okay, and in property law, being a paid property lawyer, for what I did for the past 5 years, in my own way, although not for free, I wrote three books actually about property, which is 40 questions you should ask your lawyer before buying a residential property in Malaysia. When I wrote it the first time in 2010, a few fellow lawyers came to me. Are you trying to actually bankrupt us? That's what they are saying. But I'm not selling the book for free, or actually for cheap, it's $30. Okay, and then I read another one, 40 more questions. It's a scam, actually, because I want to write to sell more. Okay, so, and then now I'm writing 40, then my second book was 40 more questions, residential property. And then the third one is 40 questions you should ask your lawyer before taking a housing loan in Malaysia. So it's explained about how you buy property and how you actually tackle the lawyers who are actually trying to scam you out of your money. That's what most people think when they go to lawyers, because the first word that comes out of most of my clients, because I'm a property lawyer, I actually help developers to sell property for them. I actually attend to clients on a scale fee. The fee is already set, but every time a client meet me, they will still ask for a discount, because that scale fee is actually what government imposed on them. Okay, and they don't want to pay for it. Okay, so most of it are actually being paid by the developer. Okay, my CSR is actually doing it for the government. I'm actually panel lawyers for a few government agencies like Syarikat Perumahan Negara. We go to kampungs, we go to marginalized people, we help. They have this program where they build houses for them. They have lands, but they don't have the money to build houses. So the government subsidize it. And they pay RM200 per month, something like that. Okay, so we are a few of the panel's lawyer who does the job for them. But this is more like CSR, not really social enterprise. Okay, so it's nearly a year ago, a few of my friends, lawyers, they are quite famous in their own rights, come together and actually thinking about how to do more than just being lawyers. Okay, and we are not trying to rope in Bar Council or anything. We are doing it among ourselves. We are trying to give documents for free. That's what I said in the other session just now, where Scott was moderating, about the Kill All the Lawyers project. Okay. Why it's named Kill All the Lawyers? We want to give the document for free. And one of the most asked about document in startup is the DNA. NDA. Sorry, non-disclosure agreement, not DNA. Okay, non-disclosure agreement. Because every time you meet up an investor, every time you meet up, whether they are angel investor or devil investor, okay, you have doubts about giving them. Telling them what's your business is all about. So that is a very important document for startups because.
So Karen, is it NDA or is it NCND?
It can be both.
Because the C one is much more critical because people can use that against you. Whereas the non-disclosure. I mean, you know, they can keep it themselves, but they can also use that to other ways to circumvent you. See?
When have the first meeting, usually
it's
NDA. Yeah. The first meeting usually NDA. So and it's much simpler. Okay, because when you meet up, you don't know where you're going yet. Okay, and after that, only then you know. Okay? So this is about a system where you actually go to the web. Yeah. And actually, you can look
so
for all these agreements.
Your documents are available on the web.
Not yet. This is what we are trying to do.
Yeah, you should be able to do that in matter of.
Try it now.
Shouldn't take that long.
For Malaysia documents, try it now. Yeah. It will be not really that accessible, seriously. So that's what I'm trying to do with a few other lawyers, and I think.
I can help you to do that. No problem. I give it you free as well. I just take the license and whatnot. Oh man. Okay. Thanks, Yaron. You can ask him about if you want to get involved in whatever he's doing and so on. So your book, is it online? No.
It is online, but it's also in physical.
Yeah.
Online, is it free? Is it open source?
No.
No.
How?
So you kill other lawyers, just keep yourself alive.
How are you selling online? Is it okay?
Not really. Actually, it's more sellable than physical. Because nowadays, I'm not sure whether you know that last year, physical book actually went more than the e-books. It's a global thing.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not because I do have a fiction book. I have two fiction book, which doesn't have anything to do with legal.
Yeah.
With Fixie, quite a popular imprint. The publisher is Fixie, so I have and I try to teach people through that too.
Okay, that's great. Good. Right. We move to our next panelist speaker, Ngai Wen. Right. She's going to talk about what.
I'm just going to first talk about what I do.
Yes,
basically.
Please.
So we can have a better.
Yes, probably we can learn more about you and what you do and so on. Okay.
Okay, for short, you can just call me UN, then that's easier, like United Nations, like that, you know? So it's born with such a name. All right, so basically, I run Kakisani right now, which is a 15-year-old platform, and we've just registered that under ROS for as an association like about 4 years ago. And I also run and founded another ROS, under ROS, Women Girls. And we run programs like Ikal Mayang, which is to enhance and grow the women's share of voice. We think that through the traditional mass media, we don't get to hear enough of women's aspiration, women's real sense of what they wanted to say. We hear them, but we're not getting a sense of what they want to be represented as proper in films, television dramas, etc., etc. So we are mooting for more women characters to be represented well enough on television and films. So that's what Women Girls do. Kaki Seni is an association that is really very much about advocacy work. So we help the artists through their struggle when they have like they wanted to do something and they needed funding or they needed direction or they needed certain roadmaps being mapped out, for example. Then we will take it up, take it on for them, with them. We will do the marketing work for them as well. We also use the arts as a tool to solve unity issues, to increase, to decrease the gap between the different segments in the society. So for example, we allow and we give access to PPR, Project Perumahan Rakyat, the disadvantaged, marginalized children in the urban environment. We give them access to music classes for free. So we just bring the coach, like a guitar coach, and the guitar, which is from public donation, and we will go around collecting old and used guitars, and we'll bring it to a PPR space, and we will have them learn that music, learn that instrument, whether it's piano, guitar, violin, whatever that they want. But we have rules, like it needs to be something that they want and they ask. If they don't ask, then we're just around consistently as an option for them to come to us and talk and do activities with. We also run a lot of programs to increase awareness about how you could use the arts, you could use the discipline of the arts to solve a lot of, to be more, we use it like as an intervention program in schools to get them more interested in schools, in education, for example. One of the programs that we ran with one of the schools is that we went into schools doing crazy 5-minuters at 7 a.m. in the morning, and we decreased greatly the amount of people who play truant and the amount of people who come late to school within that 3 months project that we had with the school. So we basically get people interested to come into school earlier at 7 o'clock instead of like at 7:15 or 7:35 when the school bells rang and they come in slowly. And also people are more likely to stay in school to talk about the stuff that we have been doing, even though it's a 5-minute project. So that was really fun. So those are the different things that we do. So about the idea of social enterprise, for example, it's obviously a difficult subject in this country. For various reasons. One, whenever people ask me, so what is it that you do? I always have difficulty explaining what I do to them because, look, I just feel like I've written an essay. And then they, after that whole essay, blah, blah, then they will still look at you glazed eyes and when I, so exactly what do you do? Oh my God. Okay, baiklah. And then after all that, they will again ask you, so you do all that, how do you get paid? Good question, kan? Tapi kalau aku tak buat, siapa buat? So, you know, that would be, but you can't say that. I just said it to you. But the whole point is that, so it was really great when the word social enterprise became a lot more popular in Malaysia. Of late, actually, it only took off maybe, say, the last, 2-3 years? Yeah. And before that, it's not heard of. And it's not as sexy, oh, I'm a social entrepreneur. It's just that we're just doing the stuff nobody else want to do. And we are fools enough to keep doing it because we believe in it so much that we think that it is important to keep going and keep doing because we are watching kids grow up now with passion. We're watching kids now wanting to do something come every weekend. So that was amazing. We're watching kids, you know, telling their parents, okay, I'm going to do this nice, but I want to be able to take 1 hour off my Saturday to do this. Is that okay? So those are the things that we are looking at, and it gives us fulfillment. So of course the big question is, how on earth do you make the money so that you get to do all this stuff? So we kind of balance it. We balance it between doing business as usual, consulting work, a lot of stuff like, you know, we go around saying, hey, check it out, I could do this, or hey, so what are you doing now? And you tell me what you do. You know, maybe you want to try do it this way, la 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 la, some idea. And then they say, oh yeah, yeah, oh, who can I ask? You can ask me, I can do it for this much. And then I will take all that money and then everything pumped right back into Kakisani and Women Girls and do the things that we know we want to do. And the reason why we were doing the work, because we get to do the things that matter to us. So that was how it used to be and how it's been. So now that with the new word of social enterprise coming up, oh, it's great. Now we have a name. Oh. So, and we have a blueprint, which is not finished. I'm sure it's going to be finished. But it's generally giving you an idea of what social entrepreneurs are about. I can't really use this word when I'm seeing a client because the banks clearly don't understand. And I don't have collaterals because in our unit or in our organization, it's really strange to say, let's buy a van. By law, the van is to do what? So that we can get a loan. So that we can get paid, you know, while we wait for the money to come in on this project that we're doing. But it won't pass because that won't be the whole, it won't stay true to the mission of what we're trying to do. Because, you know, but the bank won't give us a loan because we've got no collateral to give them. And they won't even recognize us as a social enterprise. They see us as an NGO. And now that we know that investors are only interested if you are not an NGO, because what can you give them if you're an NGO? You can't even give them shares or whatever. You can't do anything. So then it's really interesting to talk about how else can we generate revenue for NGOs, for what we're doing, for example. But then the issues on the other side is that, but the intention of what we're trying to do is to get as many people as possible to do what we're doing and to share and to do more of what we're doing. That's the intention, that's what it is. So we wanted to be able to share the simplest, easiest way of what we do. If you think you like what we're doing, so for example, if the process of how we've created, the process of how we got some unemployed girls who drop out of school at the age of 17, 16, simply because they just don't want to stay in school anymore, and we got them jobs after that, and that process, and if you like it, hell, I'll just give it to you, please do it. And if 50 other persons or 50 other organizations can do that everywhere else replicating this, awesome. If they don't have to sign up and, you know, follow our stuff because, you know, at their local level it's a bit different, then yeah, sure, please go do it. So the intention was to get them to as many to do it. So the idea of generating fees from some of the stuff that we're doing is compared to the cost, the implementation cost of the IP, maybe, you know, not balanced. So, which means I'm saying that the implementation of IP for the stuff that we're doing will be way too high compared to the supposed fee that we could generate because somebody else is interested to do what we're doing. Do you know what I'm saying? Baila. Thank you.
That's all, man. Are you finished? You're done?
Sometimes.
Are you sure?
Sometimes.
Great. I mean, you mentioned this now about what you've been doing. I think easily what you mentioned around, they got 5-10 IPs that you were mentioning just now in all the world, helping this, doing this, doing that.
I don't
that,
have time
that, yeah, so,
to do the IP
so
work. If someone can do it for me, it's awesome.
Yeah.
And then, you know, it's really... Okay, bye.
Yeah. Before I pass over to Scott, who has a pile of slides that he wants to go through, we are a consulting firm and we have a lot of the social entrepreneurs coming to us, you know, people operating what we call these for elderly parents and so on, for handicapped children and so on. What they are facing is that, you know, they are running this outfit and they're having a problem to get standard operating procedures and how to run this thing. The standard legal documents, the standard methods of how to intervene with the people. So if someone had actually packaged that, I mean, most of the NGOs will be able to move faster because all that's readily available and they can actually take it in and use it immediately. And I think they can get even sponsors to buy that for them and supply that to them so they can focus on their work and so on.
Yeah, but this is not an overnight thing.
Yeah.
You know, it's a long process. It's easily years.
Yes.
So meanwhile, kita makan apa? Jom.
Yeah. So the thing is that there are many organizations who have all this experience. We can tap on the experience and they can provide that. Yeah.
Open source.
Yes. So people like you who have been working and you start to build experience, you can actually create IPs from that and sell to others who may want to use and copy that.
Can I just add?
Yeah.
The Impact Accelerator I was talking about now, that's done exactly that.
That way, yeah.
So if someone wanted a solution for dealing with homelessness in Kuala Lumpur or homelessness in general, it's there.
So you IP that?
No. Well,
I think we've got to be careful that, you know, we need the semantics matter, right?
Yes.
Because when you're talking about IP, I've already sort of like tried to have an understanding of who's here. When you're talking about IP, I think people would understand that as the standard. I mean, we've got a lawyer here.
Sort of
lawyer.
Sorry, lawyer.
He is a lawyer. it would be IP as IP is. You register, you pay, you maintain the payment over a number of years. If anyone uses that, you sue them. You know, that's the understanding of IP. But in this space, in the social, I wouldn't just say social enterprise, let's say social impact space, because it also encompasses NGOs and other forms of organizations that deliver social impact. In this space, the people who are in it don't come with that sort of approach, right? Because they want to create the biggest impact they can. And it's not about protecting what's mine and you can't use and, you know, it's only mine, which is where IP is based. And that's absolutely fine to have that, because if you're in traditional enterprise, you need that in order to generate the most profits, or to protect your brand, or whatever reason, right? But the sort of the starting point for social impact organizations is not there.
You think so?
I know so.
Yeah.
From my own experience, having worked in this space for 10 years as an entrepreneur myself, you know, running my organization, but also being part of a global, you know, impact hub, for example. I don't know if any of you have heard of Impact Hub. Again, you can look them up, impacthub.net. But Impact Hub, for example, they have a limited IP registration because they discovered that they needed to do that to be able to capture all the sort of methodologies, the guidelines for starting Impact Hubs, for how you build communities, etc., etc. So they've done a limited IP registration for Impact Hub. But they have opened it up so that anybody can start an Impact Hub if your values align with the value of Impact Hub Association. So here in Kuala Lumpur, for example, we've started Impact Hub Kuala Lumpur. Yes, we use Impact Hub logo, and that's about the only IP we use, to be quite honest, because we've had to build everything else from scratch to suit the local context and whatever programs are suitable here. Now, we don't go and then...
But there are many other... I mean, IP has many forms. Not all the IP has to be paid. Most some of the IP can be done. You don't really need to pay anything. I mean, copyrights are no need to be paid. Contracts is another form of IP. You don't really need to do that. You can actually brand your processes and keep it as a branded IP, and you just service mark or trademark that process. I think a lot of the NGOs have very, very good processes. They have very good experience and the engagement, and they can brand that and keep it as a unique what we call process, that which they can actually trademark it as well. See, so those things doesn't really cost much. The one that costs you much is probably the patents and so on. I think the NGOs is probably less interested.
I'll share with you. We have a trademark registration for Scope Group.
Yeah.
And we only did this 5 years ago because we were asked to do it by the people who.
That's good. That's
you
good.
Know.
Yeah.
And to be honest, I think it's been an absolute waste of money. We got funded to do it, to register the IP. but we've just not seen any value, you know, really.
Well,
what if someone else is called scope group? We don't care.
Yeah,
really.
But
you know, in our case,
but,
we don't care.
But it depends on your on the strategies, because NGOs can come up with hold on. We will get Scott to give. But you want to intervene?
Yeah
please.
But you would care if someone was using the scope name and running very unsophisticated and low value projects which reflected badly on the name of scope, because that would then affect your reputation.
Yes.
And that's where the problem lies. That if it's fine if they're doing the right thing, but if they do the wrong thing, then you've got no recourse. And that's the value of a trademark, in that you have some degree of control over who uses that term and the sort of quality of service they provide under that name. It's like magic. If I went out and started saying, I'm doing social entrepreneurship under the brand Magic, and really I'm just ripping people off, it's going to affect UN.
And, so I'm not magic.
Yeah, but that's not me. I'm Magic is actually just, you know, it's actually a government arm. It's an agency. It's a government agency that comes up with a blueprint. It has nothing to do with me, even though I'm United Nations. But so, yeah. Yeah, correct. But I totally agree with you. So, like, for example, even Kakisani, which in English, it means arts addict, loosely, you know, coin. Even though we are trademarked, for example, but the reason why we're trademarking it is not because we are afraid that someone else is going to use it and degrade us. We really don't. To be honest, if someone really does that, I won't be able to have money to sue them. I won't. And given my priorities, I probably wouldn't as well. I won't. Because in the social enterprise arena or the things that we kind of do, who's doing it is really important, and who, and we're known so much by our personality as well. It's not just the brand that we carry. The only reason why we trademark it is really because we're in a sphere that is very much about creativity. It's also very much about championing the, you know, authors' rights and stuff like that, and about, you know, the right to do your work creatively, etc. And that's why we do that, and we tell people the process and how it's going to be done easily.
I think you've raised a really important question there. It's, you know, it's, and you too, by saying the recourse, right? Because it's only valuable if you are really going to take legal action. We registered and we went ahead with paying because we got a grant for it. We said, yeah, okay, why not? Because the people said, you know, just having the trademark logo there will deter a lot of people, apparently.
I mean, it's also credibility to begin with. It's really quite, you know.
Actually,
okay.
Without it, also you can sue.
Okay. Okay. Sorry,
John. Really?
But it's much
harder.
I have to stop you all there. I have to intervene. I think now I allow Scott to summarize all the discussion that we had.
Scott,
please give a fair summary of all the discussion. Thank you.
I have a couple. I will delete most after this good presentation. A couple of things. What we're doing here is a social enterprise. If we didn't make money, we couldn't be here. So one of the distinctions between being government, which you get paid from taxes, is a social enterprise has to generate funding legally, and I'm going to say that for lawyers, from some source. And you can use other investments in your business to fund impact activities. So Tom's Shoes sells one pair of shoes and gives one pair away. But if they didn't sell the first pair of shoes, they wouldn't give away too many pairs of shoes because they don't have any money to do that. So the time on that table is very valuable. What you heard was a debate that's healthy because it's the kind of items that people need to be toying with. And I'm going to poke through a couple of them really quickly because I'm going to share some views from elsewhere in the world, because I'm obviously lost. They're from Malaysia. I'm from Dubai. I've lived there for 6 years. I've lived in Australia for 20. I've lived in Japan for 2. I've spent half of my life outside of the US. I still can't speak right.
How old are you? Sorry.
as women won't answer that question, I will tell you that I'm 57 in a couple of days. So I've done more wrong than most people half my age have done right. So I can tell you, and part of what I think you guys are interested in, because I help run accelerators, I help do impact investing, I am involved with some of the biggest yachts in the world, and after natural disasters, we deliver health and education aid. And what we do is, when they had the tsunamis, we take things that are left over from other places, we ship them to the other parts of the world, and we go away, and the only thing we leave is a flag. So what we're interested in doing is creating impact. And what I'm here to do today is not share charts, even though they're giving me a bunch of stick, is I'm here to share impact and ideas with you, because if I can get one, two, or 10 of you to step out of your comfort zone, and Malaysia is comfortable.
Yes.
You guys, in my view, don't stretch. And I've talked to a lot of you over coffee and breaks, and you're talented people. I'd love to see you reach out and do some of the things you have with your talent and your abilities. I did have a lady in orange move from the back row to the front. She was the only one. Okay, a couple of things that I'm going to share in their context before I give some examples is Bill Miller used to be on the MDC and the Multimedia Super Corridors Advisory Board 25 years ago. He was the chairman of Stanford Research Institute. He was a professor at Stanford. Interesting, what if you don't get these right, none of the rest matter. You need to improve the factors of input. You need to get trade right, because if you only invent and you don't sell anything, you're called useless, or sorry, an inventor. And I don't mean that in a bad way, but if you only make one and you don't sell it, it doesn't work. And the last one is innovation and entrepreneurship go together. If you are an innovator and you don't like talking about money, find somebody who can work with you to take it to market. Social enterprise is one of those most challenging places that they're normally crusaders of girls and women, but you may need somebody who can go talk for grants or funding.
It's true.
And if you don't have that combination, it's dangerous that what you'll have is a crusade, but you're impotent. You have no money to take it forward. Sorry, I'm kind of jumping. So I look at social enterprise in Malaysia as the same point. You're where the dot is. You have a choice. If you continue doing the same thing, you will crest and you will not compete with the rest of the world who is going up the next curve. The flip side is you can build social enterprise language into your culture. You can make it okay to talk about it over coffee. You can make an economy that's robust and takes things global. And I think there's a lot of people here today. In fact, the audience, in my view, is richer in talent than the people on the stage in many ways. You guys have a lot of experience. So forgive me, I'm going to bark for you guys. Language, to the point earlier, is a little bit confusing in this space. I'll suggest this is one candidate, is that social enterprise is at the crossroads in a new place. You have to create social impact, and you have to have profits. If you don't have profits, you're called a non-profit. So government is not in this category for social enterprise. Social means you get an impact, and you generate profits. Profits is not a dirty word, even for lawyers. So if you make good money and you contribute half back as care, that's fine. Sorry. So there's a couple of quick definitions here. It's an entity that balances for impact and commercial. And this is the thing that we were kind of poking at on the front end, is a lot of times we get lost in what the impact is, and we forget that you have to have a commercial side to fuel it. In the past, we've had to cheat to get this to work. We've had grants, we've had people sell themselves on the side for consulting, and it's tricky. But the really, really important part around the world, and I'm gonna say especially in Southeast Asia, is this last one. It has to be inclusive and transparent. In most cases, books aren't open. People have to be able to show that what I contribute, 90% or some their amounts goes to the cause you're looking for. It doesn't pay for the people that are raising the money. And that's what one of the biggest problems is in a lot of these entities, is it goes to the people that are running the events. This is what we're looking for. It's kind of a new hybrid. Somebody who knows how to make money and somebody who has cause. So just as a clarity, and again, you guys jump in if I get these wrong, because I'm trying to help tie us together in a sense. is there's the traditional nonprofit, which doesn't take in funding in the traditional forms, but it takes in grants. And then you've got the traditional for-profit, which is an IBM or an Apple. Social enterprise is in between the two. Does that help? Is that consistent with what we're thinking about? Okay. These are the big areas of focus around the world. They're called the Copenhagen Consensus for what the buckets are of where you focus, which is kind of cool, right? You've got to deal with these things called civil conflicts, and you got to deal through water and sanitation. If you don't deal with those, it probably doesn't matter. By the way, for the first time in history, it's believed that technology can solve all of these within the next 20 years. The question is, can you get more people like these people here to go do it? Because I only saw two hands go up that wanted to be social entrepreneurs, which is a big worry for me that says, you guys are all greedy. Or you're playing it really safe and you're working for the government. So one or the other, you guys got to step out of your box, otherwise these are going to be your kids' problem, and they're going to really hate you. And I don't mean this in a bad way, but I'm really proud of these people standing up and being willing to talk about stuff that's hard. A living library talking about the subjects they're talking about is not something that you're going to get because you play it safe. You got to do the harder stuff. Am I okay for you guys? Okay. These guys are a bunch of the big players. These are just some names. There's hundreds in Malaysia. There's thousands in the US and Europe. So one of the problems is that Malaysia is a lagger in that place. That's why the blueprint's up. I'm going to cheat here and keep going. So there's a big opportunity in Malaysia. If there's only 100 social enterprises, what do we need to do? These are the six or seven things we need to kind of strike off the list, right? We need to improve the human capital. You guys need to feel comfortable talking about social enterprises. We need to have institutional awareness that it's not just a blueprint that's published. People in the institutions even teach about this. And you got to scale and support these people so that they don't feel like they're only on panels talking about it, that they have real people coming up afterwards keen to help them with both funding, labor, and real resources. So I'm giving you three charts for the blueprint just so you know. They're easy to digest and it's important. Obviously, I don't live in Malaysia, but I did my homework because I think this is really valuable. You guys have a pretty cool blueprint to start with. And 2018, they're looking for a measurement. So that's cool. It's near term, it's real, it's tangible. Now, it's up to you guys for more than two of you to partake in this. There are no bad ideas, just bad timing. So somebody may have taken 10 years to get there. They got there 10 years faster than everybody else because they at least started doing it. So part of this is about get out there and do it. And how many of you have ever played sports? A couple of you, right? Did you immediately go to the pros?
No.
You have to practice a bit? Yeah. Social enterprise is the number one sport you should take up in the future. Take it up as your hobby. Okay. Magic. This was your magic quote. That's the brand. That's the government one. They're the ones that did the blueprint. They are a government, Quango, quasi-government. They have some external interests. But social enterprise is something I'd like to see on everybody's LinkedIn profile in the next 5 years down in the bottom. Get a badge. Do it. It's about networking. It's a game. One of the things about this is communities that trust and know each other are the winners. And you don't need to know all the detail. I'll give all these charts you want. But at the top right, the Silicon Valley has high trust of each other that when they talk together, they'll share together. Guess what happens when you don't talk with each other and share? You end up as losers. That's what non-social communities are. Malaysia's alternating between. They like to talk to each other, but they don't like to share. So I don't need to tell you guys that, right? This is kind of something you know. So if it's technical, we share. If it's social, these guys are struggling. They're hung out in a lot of times because there's only 100 social enterprises in the country. They want more of you signing up to their communities, not making them feel like they're on hangmen over there. Okay, two more things. To succeed, you need roots before fruits. Often we talk about the outcomes. Oh, that's perfect. But the fruits that you guys want are to be not just Malaysia. You need to be connected with the rest of the world. Shoot, going the wrong way. Sorry about that. And to do that, you need a business model framework where you connect with everybody else. And these are the things that they've all been touching on. Down on the bottom is culture. You need an infrastructure and a community. You need role models. If you have no role models for social enterprise, you can't do this. If you don't have engagement or a framework, you suffer. So the reason I'm bringing this up is this is stuff I do with that portion of profits that I make through investments or consulting with the three companies I have. And I wanted to give you one last suggestion on a couple of what are these. We heard about this earlier. Airbnb doesn't own anything. This is about IP, right? What should they be doing with their money? What if they gave space for social ventures, for empty space? They listed and said, it's available. You could use it for your office space for this month. It can be done on Airbnb. They haven't done that yet, so they could do a whole social venture on that one. Facebook, how many of you are using Facebook for your business or your social venture? I know you're doing it for yourself. How many of you are doing it for your social venture? That's where you can go do it, right? Well, Kill All Lawyers is now up as of this week, right? You can go say like it. And I've included a whole bunch of resources at the back of this because I think this is a really cool area.
I'm done. Thank you very much, Scott. Okay, we are supposed to end now, but anyway, I think give some opportunities for people from the floor to ask any questions to the speakers. I mean, it's not easy for you to get all these talented experts in the area of social enterprise, social entrepreneurship. There's a lot of things you can ask so that they can share their experience and the challenges. Please, I mean, those aspiring SEs.
No, I just want to say, okay, please, you have a question.
Please.
You first.
I just wanted to ask you, because I like what you do. Sorry, can you hear me?
Yes. Okay.
Anyway, I went to Hong Kong for 10 days to do a benchmark study, Hong Kong IT industry. So we want our company to be number one in 3 years' time in the world. But we visited from manufacturing, from IT, to all the way to community, social service, welfare company. Not company, but organization. And also a school. School for children with problems, you know, like broken homes, expelled from school and everything. And those two organizations, or school and, you know, welfare community, they were probably the best benchmark study visit I've been to, even though I'm from the IT industry. There were 12 of us that went. And they're doing fantastic job because they have to be innovative. We have places like Hong Kong and Singapore, they've got no resources, but they're very, very innovative. And especially like for the school, they set targets for the kids. So I expect from school, but they ask the kid, you know, what do you want to achieve? What's your target coming to this school? Because they give them a place where it is a norm. I mean, parents are not arguing, father is not beating the mother or whatever, you know, brothers are not in jail. So give them a form of normality. So when they set a target, the kids work towards the target because that kid set the target themselves. So when they reach the target, they put a star each time. Then the next target, what's your next target, you know? So that's something I learned from that school, which I'm going to implement in our company, because I feel that we are too comfortable in the company, because being a Bumiputra company, very slow in the things they do, because they're comfortable. Any changes, they do not want to accept it, you know, even a minor change, which is for the betterment of themselves. The other thing I like the social one was because they just not work, they're very dedicated, not just the staff, but they bring it outside to the community. So I was in Kowloon, this social organization is in Kowloon. The whole community in Kowloon practice health tech. You know, they did it through 5S, where they sanitize, they have a standardization, you know, everything, the 5S principles that teaches it. And they brought this to the community, and the community started practicing it. So they tell one person it became a friend.
Okay.
You know? But it helped.
Your question, please?
The question is, do you do a benchmark? Do you, visit some of these?
These two ladies. The gentlemen?
General, same thing.
Yeah, anyone can answer that.
Of course.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you get fundings from the government and all that? I mean...
The program I just mentioned before, the one with the volunteering, the Impact Accelerator one, the idea there is basically to take models that have been proven to work elsewhere and create an impact model for Malaysia, for, you know, addressing the social issues. So yes, there is a degree of benchmarking, of course, but you know, problems have to be have to be designed with, you know, awareness about what the local needs are. So benchmarking, yes, to a certain degree, but at the execution part, no, because you've got to really design something that works for the local context. I'll share an example of another piece of work that we do, and this is more on the consulting advisory side of things at Scope Group. We worked with the Malaysian government to transform how drug users are treated in Malaysia. And for that particular program, we started off with them, of course, engaging, saying, well, you know, drug users are dying, people are getting HIV, you know, all the sort of problem angle. But then they weren't interested because, you know, this has been happening for 30 years. You know, we are trying to do something about it. It's just a difficult problem to solve. What can we do? That was the angle. So then we used this whole benchmarking approach to actually show them what are the models that are out there that have been proven to work. How are those models helpful for your situation? If you did this, could you become a benchmark for other countries? You know, that sort of angle. So yeah, we do that approach. And then they subsequently became, they are still an international benchmark for how you treat and manage drug users and prevent HIV/AIDS. But it took like 3 to 5 years before it became like that. I wanted to sort of raise the fact that you were talking about how good these social organizations were and, you know, how you're going to follow that in your own organization. I would really love to connect more entrepreneurs like you who are interested in learning from the social sector and bring those practices into your own practice, in your own business. We're hosting a community event at the Impact Hub on Tuesday next week called Mix and Fix. Okay. And the idea of the Mix and Fix is to mix people from different backgrounds, different sectors, to maybe try and solve each other's problems or at least connect. And it's on Tech for Good. So Dash is going to be there. We've also got people from Team and connecting with TechSoup Global as well. Okay. So please come along. You're all invited. 7 p.m. Tuesday 16th at Impact Hub. Impact Hub KL is in Sentul.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, I think we have to end our session. I've been asked to make sure all of you are awake up to 3 after lunch, so I do hope most of you are awake. We'd like to thank all the panelist speakers, Dr. Sariha, Khairul, Nguyen, and Scott for keeping us entertained with all the interesting issues, challenges in the area of social entrepreneurship. So if any one of you got anything else to ask to all the speakers, please catch them in the long day corridors or when they are, you see they're not doing anything. So, otherwise you can find other ways how to connect to the various organizations. I think the information is available probably in this program book. Thank you again, we like to extend an invitation for you to stay on the next for the next session. Thank you.